The World Today series, 2012 Africa, J. Tyler Dikovic, 47th edition. This book actually goes into a lot of details. It actually goes into like every nation within Africa, but we're only going to focus on Ethiopia. And so, for the record, this day is September 25th, 2013. This is the Kingdom of Ethiopia within historical background. By tradition, the Ethiopian kingdom dated back to a visit by the Queen of Sheba, open parentheses, a city in Yemen also known as Saba or Sabah, close parentheses, at the court of Solomon. Menelik I, son of Solomon and the queen, founded the Ethiopian monarchy. There are other indications that the Ethiopians had progressed at a relatively early date in African history. Herodotus, a Greek writer of the 5th century BC, described Ethiopia. Homer refers to the Ethiopians as a blameless race in his writing of about 800 BC. But for the ancient Greeks, Ethiopian referred generally to the most remote of men, most likely Nubians, whose descendants live in modern Sudan, not present-day Ethiopia. There are 45 references to Ethiopia in the Bible, but again, they point to the land south of Egypt, Nubia, rather than the area of modern Ethiopia. Little else is known of the history of Ethiopia at the beginning of the Christian era. The Coptic Christian Church established outposts in Ethiopia and Eritrea in the 4th century, and Islam arrived most probably as a result of continued contact with Arabs by the first part of the 8th century. The capital was moved from the ancient city of Aksum to Addis Ababa, and the distinctive Amharic language of the Ethiopians slowly evolved. The Christian Church in Ethiopia was established as a branch of the Coptic Christian Church, headed by the Patriarch of Alexandria in Egypt. Contact with other Christians was later severed by the Islamic Arab conquest of North Africa in the mid-10th century. Although tradition holds that the ancestors of the Somali people of Cushitic origins lived in present-day Somalia, more than 2,000 years ago, the earliest traces of people date to the 7th century AD. The Quraishite kingdom was established at that time by a group of people from nearby Yemen. We'd like to interrupt the reading just to make mention that, keep in mind that it seems like the writer is named J. Tyler Dikovic, and so that probably explains the downplaying of the truth. We're only recording this for obvious reasons. I mean, we got to put out as much information concerning Ethiopia as we can before they destroy it all. So now, continuing. Early Ethiopian European contact. In the late Dark Ages of Europe, a letter from a supposed Christian king of Africa received widespread acclaim as possibly being from an unknown people dating from biblical times. Inspired by this, a Roman Catholic pope dispatched several Dominican brothers in the 14th century to locate this Christian kingdom. The results of these efforts are not clear, but an Ethiopian emissary did reach Venice in 1402, arriving later at Lisbon and Rome. In turn, European kings and the Pope sent emissaries to Ethiopia, hoping to enlist help in the continuing crusades against the Islamic people of the Middle East and North Africa. This diplomatic effort continued unevenly for four centuries, and there was no other significant contact between this region of Africa and Europe during the passage of those years. increased penetration of Ethiopia by Europeans occurred in the 19th century. Although Ethiopia was not formally colonized by any European power, it became subject to a variety of spheres of influence of the British, French, and Italians in the latter part of the century. The succession to the Ethiopian throne was irregular. Every time a king died, there was usually a two- or three-way contest for the throne. The somewhat weak character of the nation was further complicated by periodic skirmishes and quarrels over territory with the neighboring Sudanese, who were led by religious political figures with the title Mahdi. The Somalis to the east, who were Islamic, also claimed Ethiopian territory, sometimes with the assistance of the French or the Italians. The borders of the kingdom changed countless times during this period. The modern history of the country begins with the reign of Emperor Menelik II, the first monarch to choose that name since the reign of the son of Solomon and Sheba. It was under the second Menelik that Ethiopia began to have regular contact with the outside world. Although he was at first forced to acknowledge an Italian protectorate over Ethiopia, by 1896 he had consolidated his power sufficiently to send a military force that decisively defeated the Italians. Lij Yasu, the grandson of Menelik II, succeeded to the throne in 1913, but was deposed in 1916. Zauditu, Menelik's daughter, was installed as empress. Her cousin, Rast Eferi Makonnen, ascended the throne in 1930, taking the name Haile Selassie I, which means the first power of the Trinity in Amharic. The colonial period. The Italians, the Eastern Horn, Somalia, Ethiopia, and Eritrea. In comparison to other European nations, Italian colonial efforts were relatively weak and delayed, largely because Italy itself was a weakly defined nation through much of the 19th century. Following agreement among the stronger powers in 1885, the Italians signed treaties during the next 4 years with the three Muslim sultans in the Horn region of East Africa. Although Italian Somaliland was acquired as a colony, full control was not established in the area until as late as 1927. The bleak, uniformly hot and dry region was considered to be valueless as a colony, and the nomadic Kushites and Somalis who lived in the region, including part of Kenya and Ethiopia, were difficult to control. Eritreans continued to live a life of localized independence until swept into the maelstrom of events set off by two contending forces in the late 19th century. Italian efforts to colonize the area and efforts of Menelik II, King of Ethiopia, to assemble by conquest modern Ethiopia. British and French Somaliland, both areas somewhat more desirable, separated Somaliland from Eritrea, a semi-arid expanse given to the Italians by a lack of interest on the part of more powerful colonial nations. Benito Mussolini, the fascist dictator, came to power in Italy in 1922. He began to flex colonial muscle, eyeing with envy the vast territories taken without resistance by the rest of Europe, in Africa, and elsewhere. From bases in Eritrea, Italian forces invaded ancient Ethiopia in 1936. Emperor Haile Selassie I begged for assistance at the League of Nations, but his plea fell on deaf ears. The fate of Ethiopia had been decided earlier in Paris when the British and French gave the Italians wide authority over Ethiopia in an effort to appease Mussolini. The figurehead King of Italy proclaimed himself Emperor of Ethiopia, a title recognized at once by Austria and Germany, and in 1938 by Great Britain and France. Ethiopia was joined with Somaliland and Eritrea to form Italian East Africa. Initially, there was some effort at economic development and road buildings. However, an attempt was made to assassinate the Italian governor at Addis Ababa in 1937. A reign of terror followed, with widespread arrests and summary executions in an attempt to terrorize the population. Further unrest became intense, and by 1940, the Italians were besieged from within by Ethiopian terrorists and from without by British forces. Exactly 5 years after the first entry of Italian troops, first Haile Selassie entered Addis Ababa at the head of a British-Ethiopian force, and Italian rule was ended. During the post-war period, a plan whereby Eritrea was to become a part of Ethiopia was promulgated at the United Nations. Following its acceptance, the two were joined. The United Nations granted a trusteeship over Somalia to Italy in 1949. This area had been occupied by the British since the early years of World War II. The trusteeship provided for complete independence within 10 years, which was achieved in 1960. The Federal Democratic Republic of Ethiopia. Land and people. Many centuries before the advent of modern mankind, Ethiopia was a relatively flat land of green grass and trees. Severe earthquakes occurred, causing fiery volcanoes to push skyward, spewing molten lava throughout the land. Today, Ethiopia is a land of sharp mountains rising to more than 15,000 feet. Their rough appearance is produced by volcanic rock formations. The Rift Depression enters the country in the southeast, and the majestic peaks on either side of the gorge march in parallel formation towards the Red Sea. Slightly above Addis Ababa, the mountains separate, and those on the left hand proceed north to the Red Sea at Asmara in Eritrea. The right hand peaks extend towards the Somali Republic. Some of Ethiopia's rugged terrain is surrounded by desert and arid land on all sides, encircled by mountains that form the Ethiopian highlands. The Blue Nile, originating from the waters of Lake Tana, flowed through a gorge more than a mile deep and 20 miles across in places. The climate of the highland plateaus and mountains is temperate. Frost occurs regularly above 11,000 feet, where the daily range in temperature may span as much as 80 degrees Fahrenheit from noon to midnight. The Ethiopian Orthodox Church is one of the world's oldest Christianity, having become the state religion around the same time the Emperor Constantine converted to Christianity. Tradition has it that the first Christian to be baptized was an Ethiopian noble who was on his way from a pilgrimage to Jerusalem when he met the Apostle Philip. Actually, the Bible. It's not tradition. The Bible records that. Now, baptism scenes are a recurring motif in Ethiopian art. An extraordinary feature of the Ethiopian church is its historic connection to the Old Testament and Jerusalem. Ethiopians celebrated the Sabbath on Saturday for over a millennium. Most Ethiopian churches are consecrated with a symbolic Ark of the Covenant, and tradition has it that the original Ark was brought to Ethiopia by Menelik I, son of the Queen of Sheba, following a visit to his father, King Solomon. The story of Solomon and the queen is a popular motif in Ethiopian religious art. The original ark is claimed by some to be in the church of St. Mary of Zion in Aksum. Lalibela, in a mountainous region some 400 miles north of Addis Ababa, was a new Jerusalem for Ethiopian Christians in the 13th century. 11 medieval churches were carved out of solid rock there. They have been declared World Heritage Sites by UNESCO, and are principal tourist attractions for Ethiopian visitors. The past political and economic history. For early history, see historical background and the colonial period, the Italians. Haile Selassie first became emperor of Ethiopia in 1930. Within a year, he promulgated a constitution that provided for a two-chamber legislature, but in reality, he retained absolute power over the affairs of Ethiopia. A short time later, the Italians invaded and conquered the country, but faced stiff resistance for the duration of the of their five-year attempt at colonization. Following the return of the emperor in 1941, increasing emphasis was placed on modernization of the country. The constitution was amended in 1955, providing for a chamber of deputies elected by universal suffrage to four-year terms, and a senate selected by the emperor from among distinguished Ethiopians to serve for 6 years. Another state institution was the Crown Council, a traditional institution which included the Crown Prince and the Archbishop of the Ethiopian Coptic Church, as well as other dignitaries drawn from the ruling class. It assisted in forming basic policy and was convened at the call of the monarch. Eritrea was joined with Ethiopia in 1962, but the Eritrean Liberation Front formed in 1958, organized an armed resistance that would ultimately achieve independence in 1993 after more than three decades of struggle. Ethiopia remained a deeply conservative nation ruled by an elite of wealthy landowners. The beginning of the end of this system began in the 1970s with a series of natural and man-made disasters. Drought gripped the nation in 1972. Rising prices and unemployment brought hordes of refugees to the cities from the parched countryside. The military, reacting to high prices, demanded higher salaries and started a limited military rebellion. Emperor Haile Selassie I, aged and shaken, granted a partial increase. In the south, there were riots caused by an absence of land reform. Peasants seized productive plantation land owned by absentee landlords. Civil unrest led to the deposition of the aging Haile Selassie I on September 12, 1974. A provisional administrative council of soldiers known as the Derg Committee seized the power and installed a socialist military dictatorship. Beginning what would become standard practice, the Derg summarily executed 50 members of the royal family, ministers, generals, and dignitaries of the imperial government. The emperor himself, of respiratory failure on August 22, 1975, whether he of natural causes or was, remains a subject of debate to this day.